I'm meteorologist Kirsty Zontini. We are here with a very special guest as we head into summertime. A lot of people are going to be outside, especially at night. And of course, it is fun to look up at the stars and know what you're actually looking at. We have a return guest to Cloudy with a Chance of podcast. Joe Childers is here. He is the educator at Bunshoff Museum of Discovery. And not just that, he's a very talented and educated man. So a little bit about Joe. If you maybe missed our last podcast, go back and listen to it because it was very educational. We're going to kind of take it a step further for what people need to know this year. But Joe not only loved just astronomy as a child, he took it further and decided to keep learning about it. So he actually does have a master's in physics, and he is the resident astrophysicist at the museum. And not only do you educate children, but you also educate adults as well. You're doing a little bit of teaching now?
Yeah, I am an adjunct professor for physics at Wright State, and the classes that I have been teaching are specifically the ones for education majors. Mm-hmm. So it's a really good thing that the education majors at Wright State all need to have science classes.
Yeah.
They gripe about it, but that's going to make them a whole lot more marketable once they get out there.
Oh, it definitely will.
And so I do the physics portion for them. And so really it's baby physics for people who are scared of physics, but it works out great. And we have a really good time, and it's, they learn a lot.
Yeah, so a little bit more about yourself that maybe I didn't touch on.
Okay.
If people didn't listen to our first podcast.
Sure.
You know, when did you start realizing that you loved astronomy? I know as a child, right?
Yeah, well, you know, my father, who's in the studio here
watching us,
I remember a very young age, kindergarten even, in first grade, that he was teaching me the stars that he had learned in Boy Scouts. And I remember he brought home a book from the library one time, and it was randomly about stars. I remember thinking, why do I have a star book? But I read it anyway, because he knew I would. And so we were just learning the star names and everything like that. And I remember we came back from a library presentation that he had taken me to. It was about whales.
Okay.
And he pointed up at the sky and he says, "What's that star?" And I said, "That's Gemma." And I was in like first or second grade.
Mm-hmm.
But that's one of the memories that I have. My dad and both of my parents, they never really stifled my curiosity, but they cultivated that.
That's wonderful.
He would always be willing to answer questions with me or just talk about random topics. Maybe he didn't quite know what he was talking about, but he could know a second grader.
Exactly.
And the important thing was that he kept me interested in science.
That's wonderful. That was actually going to be one of my questions was, if someone has a child that is interested in science or space and the stars, mm-hmm. and maybe the parent doesn't know much about it, what can they do to encourage their kids or keep fueling that curiosity? I would assume places like Bunshoft, because remember, not everyone in the Miami Valley listens to our podcast. Sometimes we have people from across the country.
Sure.
But there's a version of a Bunshoft, you know?
Yeah.
There's resources.
Your local science museum, so like the Bunshoft. But the Bunshoft in particular has all sorts of different accreditations, our zoo, our archaeology accreditation, and we have our sister sites, Fort Ancient and Sunwatch, about Native American cultures. I think that the most important thing is to just not treat their science questions as stupid. It's much better to say, "I don't know the answer to that, let's go find out together," than it is to say, "That's not an important question."
Right. That's a great point. And something easy that everyone can take away. It doesn't have to be science either.
No.
If your child is curious about anything, of course, finding the answer together is always a good thing to do. So talking a little bit more about Bunshoft.
Sure.
If someone doesn't know what the Bunshoft Museum of Discovery is,
sure.
Let's talk a little bit about what exactly it is for people.
Okay. So when you pull up to the museum, you're going to see our little emblem, which is a box with the lids open, and there's all sorts of different things inside. There's an otter. We have a zoo.
Right.
There's a picture of Saturn because we have our planetarium.
Mm-hmm.
There is an arrowhead on there because of our archaeology connections. And so then when you come in, the planetarium's on the left, the zoo is upstairs, the little kids' play area is right in front of you, the science central is down towards the left.
Mm-hmm.
And one thing I've noticed as I've traveled to other museums, we have a pretty frequent schedule of on-floor activities where,
that's wonderful.
You know, it's like every hour or so,
you
know, go up to the discovery table. We're going to be talking about earthquakes today.
Nice.
And And so it's a very varied experience. Mm-hmm. And again, you know, astronomy wasn't the only thing I was interested in growing up. It
right.
just happened to be where I ended up.
Yeah.
And so there are opportunities all over the museum for a wide variety of interests. We even have a place where you can go and just watch birds and
That's
bird
awesome.
Books and binoculars. And
yeah, a nice, safe, controlled environment.
Exactly.
No matter what the weather is, you could take your child there and have
yeah.
a good time.
Yes, exactly.
Now, another thing that's really cool that Boonshoff does is the Super Science Saturdays.
Yes.
And meteorologist McCall Rideggs, she has been a part of them.
Mm-hmm.
She will be one that's coming up, actually, May
okay.
11th.
Yes.
So let's talk about that one. Well, first of all, let's just say, what exactly are these Super Science Saturdays? Because
okay.
they sound really cool.
Okay, Super Science Saturdays are quarterly days on Saturday, of all things.
Right.
Where we have free admission, we have a theme, and we have all sorts of activities all across the museum around that theme. So the upcoming one is on May 18th, I believe it is.
Oh, yes.
And the theme is Moon Mission. So it's kicking off our celebration all summer of the Apollo 11th 50th anniversary.
That is awesome. So just if you can give us a sneak peek, what would be some of the activities?
Okay. We're going to be doing activities with rocketry.
Cool.
So, I'm not sure. They said it was going to be. They said it was going to be inside. So it's probably mm-hmm. not like combustion
not
rocketry.
Launching. Right. We're not going to be launching rockets with the kids or anything like that.
But balloon rockets we've done plenty
yeah.
of times inside, and it illustrates Newton's third law.
Mm-hmm.
And so rocketry, I know there is. Coming down the pike, I believe later in the summer,
mm-hmm.
but we're actually going to be getting an exhibit which has one or two of the actual consoles from Mission Control.
Wow.
During the Apollo missions.
That's neat.
That is going to be pretty cool. So Moon Mission, it's going to be focused on the moon stuff, and the
right.
rocket one is one that I know about.
Right.
And of course we'll be having our planetarium shows
yeah.
in the dome, which we'll be talking a lot about the moon during those shows.
That's awesome, and people love to learn about that. And it's not just for your kids. I mean,
no.
it's neat to learn about these things as adults as well.
Yeah, when I have an audience for my live planetarium show, and it's caretakers and little itty-bitties,
mm-hmm.
you know, I have to make a choice. So I'll talk mainly to the little itty-bitties. It's like, mm-hmm. oh, look at the sun. It moves across the sky. Have you ever sat on a spinning chair?
Right.
You know, you can pretend that the room's moving, not you, and that's why the sun moves across the sky. But I also slip in things
yeah.
for the adults, you know. It's like, I can say, you use the Big Dipper to find the North Star, but then I can also say, and the angle between the horizon and the North Star is your latitude.
Yeah.
And that's for the littles, but,
right, but
it keeps the adults engaged.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh, fun fact there I could take away.
Yeah, that's exactly.
So a little bit about summertime, now that we're getting close to it, and we had a meteor shower drought for a while in the beginning
yes.
of the year where there's just nothing to look at.
Mm-hmm.
And then April, that was our first meteor shower of the year?
Yeah, late April,
late
early May.
Yeah, I think there's one around
Aquarius.
The first of the
yes.
year, but like in terms of that people would actually want to get outside.
Right.
And yes, there May 5th and 6th was the peak for the Eta Aquarius.
Yes.
Okay. I actually had someone write on my Facebook page and said, I'm pretty sure I saw a shooting star last night.
Great.
Kirstie, it blew up in the sky and it was clear and I'm pretty sure that was it. Was it it? And I was like, yes, there's a meteor shower that's active right now.
I have a Facebook friend from Indonesia,
oh.
and the farther south you go for that particular meteor shower, the
right,
more you'll see.
Yes.
I mean, he had it pretty much at the zenith,
oh,
and
neat.
He saw tons of them, and he saw a fireball that had a persistent colored trail, and he's like, Joe, is that, what was going on? What was going on? And I'm like, well, that was the Eta Aquarii meteor shower.
Right, that's amazing. Fireballs and meteors, I think people get a little confused
sure.
about what they're seeing, so that's a perfect segue. You know, meteor shower, you think of a shooting star, but I know the AMS keeps track of fireball reports.
Yes.
And we show a lot on Daybreak or really any time on Channel 7 when we get good fireball video
mm-hmm.
because it is truly amazing.
Yes.
But if I'm at home and I see something and I can't really differentiate, well, was that a fireball? Should I report it? Or was it a meteor?
Okay.
What is that thing that takes that classification away from a meteor and up into fireball status?
Well, technically it's just the brightness.
Right.
But what's going on, there's pretty much three stages to it. So the little shooting star that you see is a piece of dust, and it's burning up and disintegrating very rapidly as it moves through the Earth's atmosphere.
Right.
And its speed is enough that even with the atmosphere so thin, hundreds of miles up, that's where it happens.
Mm-hmm.
The next larger size of meteorite is going to persist long enough that the outer layers disintegrate off first. And so that was the persistent trail that I was telling my friend about.
Right.
If it's large enough, then not only will you get that trail, but at some point the internal heat from the friction moving through the atmosphere is just going to make it shatter.
Okay.
And that would be the explosion, and I think that's what's called a bolide.
Yes, because some people can actually hear an explosion.
Yes, exactly. Now, it is a couple hundred miles up.
Right.
So when you see one, there's a lot of other people around you seeing it too.
Yes,
yeah.
Yes.
And in fact, one of the flow charts that we have for determining when somebody brings in a meteorite, which is almost always a meteor wrong.
Oh.
Yeah. Nice. Did you see it fall?
Right.
Is usually the key that it was not a meteorite.
Yeah.
But one thing that you need to keep in mind is that a fireball is almost always going to be very fast.
Okay.
I have seen maybe four fireballs in my life, and it's always out of the corner of my eye, and by the time I look over it, it's almost gone. So if you're seeing something that is persistent, that lasts more than a second, it wasn't.
Right.
And yet they do happen.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, the more outside you are, and the more, you know, alert you are to those things. But there have been times when I've just been driving along, and there it goes.
Wow.
And it's just really cool.
It is so cool.
You're in the right spot at the right time.
Yeah, it definitely makes you feel very lucky. We caught a fireball on our Troy weather camera.
Ooh.
That was so cool. We have it online. I think you just Google Troy, Ohio fireball.
Sure.
And it should show up. But I remember that night we got all these reports of people that were like, something just blew up in the sky. What was it? What was it?
Yeah.
Pretty sure a meteor shower was peaking and it was one that could produce fireballs. And so I remember I pulled back the camera, the time lapse all the way back a couple of hours, and then just sat there and watched the video, and it was like, phew. And it was so neat.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen one in real life and then one off of one of our weather cameras.
Yeah,
but it's definitely
unique. Yeah. I've definitely been lucky to have seen as many as I've seen.
Very cool. So summer, back to summertime.
Sure.
People can be pretty lucky to see a lot of things in the summer sky.
Yes.
And you are our resident expert as well.
Oh, okay.
So
I'll accept that.
Yeah, we're going to need you to help break it down. Of course, we don't always get lucky with the meteor showers that, you know, are peaking when we have a new moon or you don't have to worry about moonlight. This summer, the big meteor shower you had mentioned to me before.
The Perseids.
Yeah.
A 93% full moon on that peak night.
Oh.
And so just like you will see more meteors if you go out in the country than if you stay in the city because of the city lights, well, the moon has the same light appellation effect. And so the Perseids are prolific enough that you're not going to see none.
Yeah.
But it's just annoying that the moon is so bright.
Right.
Your eyes can never really adapt.
Okay. Still worth people's time, though, to look.
Oh, definitely.
Because some of the brightest ones will show through. You'll still...
Oh, yes.
It's still
yes.
worth your time. When is that peak?
That peaks around August 12th or 13th. And in fact, that's 2 days after my birthday.
Wonderful.
And we would always camp out in our backyard for the Perseids. So that was another way to have me have a childhood connection to astronomy.
Right, and to kind of encourage that curiosity.
So the best way to look for meteors, whether it is a meteor shower or just the random ones that happen every day, is to look in the morning.
Okay.
Like right before the sky begins to brighten.
Right.
The, you know, 3 to 4 o'clock or 2 to 3 o'clock, depending on the summertime, you know, how early twilight starts. And that is because most of the speed that comes to cause the meteorite to burn up is Earth's orbital motion around the sun, and of course the bits piece, its orbital motion too. And just like how you get more bugs on your front windshield than on your back windshield, if I'm on this spot and the Earth is moving this way, well, it's in the morning when my spot on the Earth is facing in the direction that the Earth is moving.
That makes sense.
That is why you have meteorites. You see shooting stars much more frequently in the morning.
That is something I never knew, actually. I just learned something, and everyone else probably did as well. That's great to know. So early morning hours.
Yes. Of course, you want to get away from as much light as you can.
Right.
Thank you, Moon, for the Perseids. And the other thing that is not, the two other things that are not readily appreciated, it's a great group activity, particularly when three of you see a really nice one and one person got left out. Well, you can work with that for, you know, teasing him for another 5 or 10 minutes until he's the one that sees one that you didn't.
Yes.
So it's, you know, stargazing is not really thought of as a group activity, but when you have things happening in the sky, then it does become one. The other thing is, it's summertime, it's warm, you're camping, say, but you don't realize that if you're lying on the ground for a long time looking at the stars, that's just going to suck the heat right out of you.
Yeah, that's true.
So bean bags or folding lawn chairs, just something to get you up off of the ground, will just help you enjoy the meteor shower a whole lot longer.
Yes, no matter what time of year, that is a great tip to have. What about some planets? I get a lot of photos of people that don't realize that, you know, Venus and Mars, even Jupiter, you get a good chunk of the year where they're either visible in the morning, or you can have your evening planet, like Mars is good. We talked about Mars last time, at that reddish tint.
Yes.
So in the summertime, I guess, what are two easy planets that people could look for?
The two easiest planets are going to be Jupiter and Saturn. In early June will be when Jupiter rises, when the sun sets, and so is visible all night long. And
that's
about a
awesome.
Month later for Saturn. So they're going to be visible in the evenings.
Perfect.
All summer long, and not in the evenings in the west, setting soon after the sun does, but in the east, so they're all visible all night long.
Right, truly go through the entire night sky.
Yeah. Jupiter and Saturn, so as you look south, you'll be seeing Jupiter low, and then Saturn is to its left, and fainter, but neither one of them twinkles. That's one way that you can tell planets from stars.
Yes.
But they're going to get closer and closer. Now, it's every 30 years or so that Jupiter catches up to Saturn.
Really?
And that next is happening in December of 2020.
Cool.
So this summer, and particularly because Saturn is near the teapot asterism, the little pattern of bright stars there, and Jupiter is in the middle of Scorpio, which is also bright stars.
Yeah.
You'll be able to watch them
get closer.
Closer and closer, you know, from week to week if you keep track of that.
Yes.
And so that would be pretty exciting. It'll be around November or so when they move behind the sun.
Right.
And then they will appear again in the mornings in, say, February or so. And that whole summer, you'll be able to get them, see them closer and closer.
That is really awesome.
Yeah.
So that's a fun nighttime activity that people can take part
of. Yeah. Our vantage point for looking at the planets is changing as we orbit the sun. Mm-hmm. And their position is changing as they orbit the sun. So, for instance, it's unlucky this summer for Mars and Venus. Mars is disappearing into the sunset and passing behind the sun, and Venus is also passing behind the sun. But late June will be a chance to see Mercury, conveniently in the evening hours.
Okay.
So Jupiter, Saturn, and Mercury are the big ones for this summer.
This summer, those are your three planets. Take note of. That's good to know. And again, yes, because Venus can be great if it's in our view.
Yes, that's
unfortunately,
true.
That doesn't always get to happen. Let's talk a little bit about the total solar eclipse.
Okay.
Kind of wrap up with that. Joe and I got to work together when we had the Great American Eclipse. Mm-hmm. That was amazing. And we were just partial here in the Dayton area, but everyone was talking about it. Mm-hmm. Everyone needed glasses. People were traveling to get into the path of totality.
Sure.
But April 8th, 2024, Dayton is in the main event.
Yes.
What does that mean when we say, like, we're even more excited for 2024?
Okay. So the partial eclipse was, as you said, very cool, and everybody got excited about it.
Yeah.
But the difference between a partial eclipse and a total eclipse is like, for your 16th birthday, being given a Ford Festiva versus being given a BMW.
Right.
It is so much better. And that is why people don't fly all over the world to see every partial eclipse.
Right.
They fly all over the world to see the total eclipses.
Yes.
The The beauty of the total eclipse comes from the corona, which is the outer atmosphere of the sun, not the part that's so bright that we can't look at it without the glasses.
Right, because it would, damage our eyes.
But it's lost in the glare of that photosphere. Mm-hmm. When the moon blocks it, then you can see the corona. And the astrophotographers are getting closer and closer, but everyone who has seen one of those says that no picture can compare. And they will have, they'll have everything prepared. They say, oh, I'm going to take these pictures. I got this telescope all set up. And then it happens, and they're like, and they forget to do all of their stuff
because
it's so mesmerizing. Awesome. So I am really hoping that it'll be clear here in April. That's your job.
Guys, right. Nothing would be worse than being in the path of totality, and we have a rainy forecast. Yep. And not just scattered storms, but like overcast.
I bet people who rent plane rides are going to be busy that day, especially if it is cloudy.
They're definitely going to be busy because they just got to get above that cloud deck
exactly.
And they get to have a great show.
Mm-hmm.
So April 8th, 2024, I know it seems crazy that we're talking about this far away, but it is worth it.
Oh.
You want to mark your calendar and just and know that this is going to be huge for this area, for the
mm-hmm.
Miami Valley. You're going to get a ton of people coming in.
Mm-hmm.
Just to be a part of it, too.
Yeah, we're one of the larger cities. It misses Cincinnati and Columbus.
Yep.
So I believe Cleveland gets it.
Mm-hmm.
But for our area, we're it.
This is it. Yeah,
it's going to go through, like, midwestern Kentucky, which there isn't. I don't think Louisville gets it. No, Louisville doesn't get it.
Louisville, So for people, then, that were maybe really nervous last time around because we kept stressing you need to wear glasses, you cannot just look at this,
mm-hmm.
or pinhole projection, anything that'd give you that secondary view, why can they skip the glasses this time of year, or how should they properly watch it?
Okay, to say that they can skip the glasses is not right.
No.
Whenever it's the partial eclipse, when there's part of that very bright part of the sun, you must have the glasses on.
Yes, you only get
and
a little window.
You not only that, but even just a little bit of accidental sun exposure is going to permanently damage your eyesight. So this is not something to kid about.
Right.
But during totality, when the moon is completely covering mm-hmm. the very bright photosphere, then you won't see anything through the glasses because the corona is not bright enough to shine through.
That's true. Yeah.
But if you're watching with groups
mm-hmm.
In particular, then there will be people there that will say, okay, glasses off now.
Right.
Yeah.
So have a guide. That would be a great idea. But just know, it's definitely going to be really neat. You probably want to start looking for glasses now. That was such a scramble for people to get them with the last one.
I have so many people who said, I'm saving my glasses from last time.
Yeah.
Yeah. They find out I'm an astronomer, and they say, hey, solar eclipse, I've got my glasses still.
And you're like, okay,
great.
Good. Sounds good to me. So, Joe, anything else about the summertime or Boone Shop that you want to talk about real quick?
We are doing astronomy summer camps for the first time.
Nice. That is
so
great.
We have a week-long mission to the moon
mm-hmm.
Where the kids can devise their own spaceship and mission to go to the moon. And we also have a day astronomy camp where it's a similar thing. They're going to design a mission to go explore something nearby, like one of the nearby stars or maybe a planet or a moon.
Awesome.
And those registrations are open, and I talked about the Apollo console that's coming.
Mm-hmm.
And over the summer through the month of June, you can watch our new exhibit about Ice Age animals in our main lobby be installed.
That's going to be really neat. So, Joe, always great to speak with you.
Same here.
Again, we've done a podcast before. He talks about even though it was, I think, last summer maybe that we had you on.
I don't recall, but
I don't remember exactly. But go back, listen to the podcast because, he talks a lot more about tips for viewing meteor showers and a little bit more about planets and things of that nature as well. So always great to have you with us for Cloudy with a Chance of Podcast. And again, you can listen to us anytime on Apple Podcasts, Google Play, Stitcher, WHIO.com. And because this is a video cast or a vodcast, you can, of course, watch us on your streaming devices like Roku or Apple TV. Thanks so much for joining us. We'll see you next time.